Good morning, students. In this class, today we will discuss the remaining topics of the chapter enzymes. In the last class, we have learnt about the introduction of enzymes, that is their discovery, and about what are the enzymes and what are the structure of the enzymes, that is the tertiary structure of the enzyme, and different chemical reactions which are undergoing in the living organisms, all the metabolic reactions which are undergoing in the living organisms, and the enzymatic conversions. In this also we have learned about the activation energy, how the enzyme substrate complexes are formed, about the active sites and all, and nature of the enzyme action. In this we have known how the enzyme and substrate complex is formed by the theories, the hypothesis which are proposed, like the lock and key model and the induced fit hypothesis, like this. And now in this today's class, we will learn about the remaining topics. Those are the factors affecting enzyme activity and the classification of nomenclature of enzymes and the cofactors. Now let us know what are the factors affecting the enzyme activity. The activity of the enzyme can be affected by change in the conditions which alter the tertiary structure of the protein. Means how the enzyme works, the activity enzyme works by the affecting the tertiary structure of the protein. That is, we know the enzyme is having the tertiary structure, like all enzymes are nothing but the proteins. They are mainly having the tertiary structure. Then if any change in this tertiary structure is occurring, then the activity of the enzyme differs, or it is affected. That is, there are some factors which affect this tertiary structure. These are temperature, pH and substrate concentration. Let us know how these factors affect the activity of the enzyme. Temperature. Temperature is a very important factor because enzymes are tertiary proteins. With increase in temperature, the hydrogen bonds, which are essential for maintaining the structure, they break. It means the hydrogen bonds which are responsible for maintaining that structure, they break if the temperature is increased. With the increase in temperature, the activity of the enzyme gets affected. So suppose if the temperature is increased, then the activity of the enzyme gets affected. So the normal range, the temperature range varies from 25 degrees centigrade to 40 degrees centigrade. That is, enzymes work at these temperatures. So activity of enzyme works at normal temperature, that is the range between 25 degrees centigrade to 40 degrees centigrade. At this range, the enzymes work properly and effectively. For any factor, there are three cardinal points: the minimum, optimum and maximum. Minimum means the temperature below this point, the enzyme activity will stop, and the optimum means point where the enzyme activity will be maximum. So at the where the enzyme activity will be more, that point is called as the optimum point. And maximum, the temperature beyond the optimum point, that is this point means optimum point, the enzyme activity will stop. So the temperature below the optimum point, the enzyme activity will stop, or the temperature above the optimum point also, the enzyme activity will stop. And where will the enzyme activity will be maximum is, it is at the optimum level. Okay. Each enzyme shows its highest activity at a particular temperature called optimum temperature. It means the enzyme activity will be maximum at the optimum temperature. But in human body, the enzyme activity is maximum at the sub-optimum temperature. That means no need to reach till the optimum, that is no need to reach till the maximum temperature, only till sub-optimum temperature only the body affects, that body temperature is maintained. So here we say sometimes fever is good, that is if we have a little temperature, that means the enzyme activities are, the enzyme activity is more and it is killing the pathogens. and it is not like that the temperature should be very high. A mild fever is good, but not a very high temperature. At very high temperature, the enzymes gets denatured, that is, they get destroyed. So with the increase in the temperature, the enzyme activity first increases and then decreases. So you can see in the graph, the first, the enzyme activity, it is increasing. So that as the temperature is increasing, the enzyme activity is increasing. First, it increases. And then after reaching to the optimum temperature, then it starts decreasing. So even if the temperature is increased more, then the enzyme activity will be decreasing. So it is first, the graph will be shown as first increases and then decreases. So activity of enzyme declines both below the and optimum and above the optimum value. So enzyme activity will be less in below the optimum level and also the above the optimum level. Low temperature preserves the enzymes in a temporarily inactive state. Now here it means so at the low temperatures the enzymes are inactive state, that is, suppose we preserve the food in the fridge. Why we preserve food in the fridge? To store for 1 or 2 days, right? Like this, why we, the food is getting stored and it is not getting spoiled if we keep in the fridge? Because fridge is having some low temperature, and in the low temperatures the microbes or the bacteria which are having the enzymes in it, they cannot work. The enzymes which are present in the bacteria, they gets inactive, that is, they won't work. So if the bacteria and the microbes which are not functional, which becomes inactive in the very low temperatures, then the food will not get spoiled. That is the reason we keep the food for preserving. We keep the food in the fridge for preserving. That means in the low temperatures, the enzyme activity will be the less. That means the enzymes will be in the inactive state. It is not getting denatured. It is getting in. It is in the inactive state. When it gets denatured in the high temperatures, when the food is kept in a very high temperature, the enzymes gets denatured. That means the enzymes will be destroyed. But in the low temperatures, the enzymes will be in the inactive states. That is what here it is. Low temperature preserves the enzyme in a temporarily inactive state. High temperature destroys the enzymatic activity because the proteins are denatured by heat. Here there is an exception. Like in the last class we have learned, high temperatures the enzymes are getting denatured, but there are some exceptions, like in thermophiles, in the organisms which live in the high temperatures, that is Thermus aquaticus. In that, the TAC polymerase enzyme is there, I told. This is these enzymes can survive even in the, this enzyme activity will be more even in the high temperatures, above 80 to 90 degrees centigrade also, the enzyme activity will be there. This is one exemption in the thermophilic organisms. But these organisms which are having high, which can, the enzymes activity is even more even in the higher temperatures, this is used in the biotechnology purpose, that is in the PCR techniques which are used in the biotechnology process. These organisms are useful, very much useful, because the enzymes can work even at the higher temperatures. This is about the factor of temperature. Coming to the next factor, that is the pH. pH is basically hydrogen ion concentration in a medium. Each enzyme has a optimum pH range. pH is nothing but the hydrogen ion concentration in a medium. So here each enzyme has a optimum pH range. That means different enzymes have different optimum pH. It is not like a temperature, it is same for all enzymes. That is, every enzyme, if the temperature increases, it increases above the optimum, means it gets denatured. But here pH is also same like temperature. It also, after reaching optimum, it will also gets denatured. But here each enzyme has an optimum pH range, means different enzymes has different optimum pH. So we see the examples for this. Salivary amylase has optimum pH 6.8 near the near to neutral. That means if we see 7 as a neutral, that is in this pH, it is not either acidic or the it is not either basic. It is alkaline, somewhat neutral. It is not basic or not acidic. It is neutral. And at this salivary amylase is having an optimum pH at 6.8 and not a 7. 7 is the neutral one. 6.8 is a 8 means little less to the 7. That is, it is little acidic. Pepsin has 1.2 to 1.8 optimum pH, which is acidic. That is, it is having very less pH. That is 1.2 to 1.8 means it is having very less. So it is acidic. The pH optimum pH is acidic. And so all these salivary amylase, pepsin, trypsin, all these are the digestive enzymes. Almost these pH varies either more than 7 or more or below 7. That is, either it may be acidic or they may be basic or alkaline. Here trypsin is little bit alkaline. That is, it is having more pH, more than 7. So, that is 8.6 to 8.8, the optimum pH is there. We know now optimum pH means the enzyme activity where it is maximum, that is called as the optimum. So here the optimum pH means the trypsin enzyme will be acting more, the enzyme activity will be more at the 8.6 to 8 point range. In the similar way, pepsin enzyme, the optimum pH will be, means the enzyme activity will be more at the 1.2 and 1.8 between. And but salivary amylase, it has optimum pH at the 6.8. This is how different enzymes are having different optimum pH. All enzymes have same optimum temperature, but different enzymes have different pH. As I said, for temperature, almost all enzymes having a same optimum temperature, that is from 20 to 40 degrees centigrade. But here, different enzymes will have different pH. The pH at optimum, the enzyme activity will be more. So, enzyme activity will be more around 6 to 8 between, that is 7, which is the neutral. At that point, the optimum pH will, the enzyme pH, activity will be more, that is at the optimum level. When pH below optimum, the enzyme activity decreases. So here the enzyme activity, which after reaching the optimum pH, that is specific enzyme will have a specific optimum, I said, after reaching that optimum, if above that optimum level, the enzyme activity will be decreasing. When pH is above optimum, the enzyme activity gets denatured. Denatured means it is getting destroyed. And hydrogen ion responsible for denaturing of this enzyme. This is how the pH factor is affecting the rate of the reaction. This is pH is similar to the temperature. Even this is also first rises and then decreases. Like the same temperature also, first it increases and then decreases. After reaching the optimum, it gets decreases. Even here pH also, it first increases and then it decreases. This is about the pH factor. The next factor is the substrate concentration or the concentration of the substrate. An enzyme normally has many active sites. Enzymes will bind with substrate molecules. You know, in the last lesson, in the last class, we have learned that enzyme and the substrate molecules, these molecules will bind to the enzyme in the active site. Active sites are the pockets of the enzyme. See, so pockets, in that pockets only substrate chemicals, these chemicals will come and bind to the enzyme. So after binding, ES complex is formed, the enzyme substrate complex is formed, and later these substrate are turned into products, leaving the enzyme free. Again the active sites will be free, and again it can accept the other substrates. So here, see, the enzyme is letting free and the products are formed here in the diagram. So here what you understood, 100 active sites are there in an enzyme is 100 substrate molecules can be formed, and 100 substrate molecules, if they bind, means how many products we will get? 100 products will be formed. So if continuously increase in the substrate, then there is the increase in the product molecules. If suppose here two substrate molecules are there, means we are getting two products. In the same way, if there are 200 substrate molecules are there, it is getting binded to the enzyme, then how many products will be formed? Then also will 200 products are only will be formed like that. Suppose 500 substrate molecules are coming and binding to the enzyme, is how many products are formed? 500 products are formed. So now you understood that how many substrate molecules will get attached to the enzyme, the same number will be the products. So the same number will be the that means the how many the substrate molecules get binds to the enzyme is after in the presence of the enzyme, the substrate molecules will be converted into the products. So here suppose the substrate molecules are more and the active sites are less. That is, if you say there are 1000 active sites in an enzyme, but there are if there are how many substrate molecules can bind to the enzyme? 1000, right? So 1000 active sites means only 1000 can bind to that enzyme, and products also 1000 only can be formed. But if the substrate molecules goes on increasing, but there are no active sites free, here all the active sites are blocked, there are no free active sites, all the substrate molecules they occupied their active sites, but still many substrate molecules are present, but the enzyme is not having any free active sites. So but we how many products we will get? Even though we will get only 1000 products, if we are if the substrate molecules are 110 substrates are there, how many products we will get? But enzyme is having only 1000 active sites, so only 1000 products only it can form. Why? Because only 1000 active sites are bounded with that substrate, and these only are get converted into products. We can't get 1100 products, 10 products. So here if the products are free, and that is they are leaving the enzyme and the products are free, and the active sites are again ready to accept the substrate, then the again the substrate can go and fill into the active site. So here what is happening, if more the substrate molecules, the enzyme activity or the products formation is not increasing, it is a steady. That is, how many substrate molecules are there, those many products are only formed. That means the graph is steady, that is not increasing or decreasing, it remains steady. We will see this in the graph now. If we represent a graph between the enzymatic activity and the substrate concentration, there is an increase in the graph, and first it increases and then it becomes steady. So here, with the increase in the substrate concentration, the velocity of the enzymatic reaction rises at first. Here enzymatic activity is nothing but the rate of the reaction, and the rate of the reaction is represented as the velocity of the enzymatic action also. So here we can say instead of enzymatic activity, we can say the velocity of the enzymatic reaction. So here the substrate concentration, as the substrate concentration is increasing, the rate of reaction is also increasing, but at a certain point it stops and then it becomes steady. That is, that Vmax, which is represented as a Vmax at that level, that means here this is called as a saturation point. At that saturation point, the substrate concentration, even though if it increases also, the rate of reaction does not increase, it remains steady. The enzyme molecules are fewer, that means all the active sites are blocked, than the substrate molecules, and after saturation of these molecules, there are no free enzyme molecules to bind with the additional substrate molecules, then the rate of the substrate concentration becomes steady. As I said, even if the substrate molecules are more and there are no free enzyme sites, that is no active sites in the enzyme, then what happens, even the substrate concentration is more also, the enzyme activity, it remains same. That means how many the substrate molecules are there, those many only products can be formed, but not extra. So here saturation point, after reaching a saturation point, the substrate, even the substrate concentration increases also, there is no increase in the rate of reaction. The reaction ultimately reaches a maximum velocity, that is V max. As I said, the rate of reaction can be represented as velocity. So after reaching the V max, that is the maximum velocity, which is not exceeded by any further rise in the concentration of substrate. That means the V max, where we represent the V max, that means even though substrate concentration increases also, it does not increase. That point is called as a V max. Substrate concentration is required to cause the half the minimal reaction rate, that is half of V max, is termed as the Michaelis constant. Michaelis-Menten constant is a Km value which represents the half of the V max. That is, V max, we know it is a maximum saturation point represented in V max, and half of the V max, that means if the V max value is 100, the V max by 2, that is half of the V max, will be 50. At the 50, this velocity, this is termed as the Km value. That is, at here, how many substrate molecules bind to the active site? We have to decrease by half. That is, the V max should be half, and half of the substrate concentration only we will take, and this is represented by the Km value. Suppose you can say, lower the Km constant is having the higher affinity of the substrate of the enzyme. Here it means, if one enzyme is taken, here it is having some V max as the 100, and at the 50 point it is filling half of the enzyme molecules, the active sites of the enzyme, half of the enzyme activities, active sites are filled, right? Understood? The enzyme which is having the active sites, half of the enzyme active sites are filled, still half are remaining. So this half are filled, at a certain level the substrate concentration is also high, and at this point is the Km value. And suppose this K1 for one enzyme, here the Km is 50, and other enzyme is there, and here that enzyme concentration, it rises up till 70, and it again it stops. The V max is 70. Suppose if you assume it is as a 70 and it stops, and it is a steady. So what will be the half of the V max? It will be 35, right? So 35 is the Km of the second enzyme. So here at this 35 means it is a half of the, for that particular enzyme, half of the active sites are filled. So which enzyme is fast? Here you can say which rate of the reaction is fast for first enzyme or the second enzyme is the rate of reaction is fast in the second enzyme, because the Km is reaching very fast. At the 35 only it is the Km is reached. That may, and for the other enzyme, for the 50 it is reached. So which is having more Km is the second enzyme, because at the 35 only half of the enzyme active sites are filled. So which is filling fast, that will only be the rate of the reaction will be more. Here this is represented as the Km, that is nothing but the Michaelis constant. We can say it is as the substrate concentration required to cause half of the maximal reaction rate is termed as the Michaelis constant. Lower the Km constant is the higher the affinity of the substrate and the enzyme. That is, more the enzyme activity will be more, the affinity of the substrate and enzyme will be more. Higher the Km constant, lower the affinity of the substrate and the enzyme. So this is about the substrate concentration increase in the, this is also one factor how the enzyme activity is getting affected with the increasing in the substrate. Let us learn about the enzyme inhibitors. These are the chemicals which stop the activity of the enzyme. Those chemicals are called inhibitors, and the process is called inhibition. Means here the inhibitors are the chemicals which stop the rate of the reaction, that the activity of the enzyme is stopped. These chemicals are called as the inhibitors. The inhibitors are of three types. They are competitive inhibitors, non-competitive inhibitors, and feedback inhibitors. All these inhibitors, they stop the activity of the enzyme. Competitive inhibitors. The inhibitors that resemble the substrate in their molecular structure and prevents the activity of the enzyme are called competitive inhibitors. See, in the diagram you can see the enzyme is there and the active sites is also there. The active site is having somewhat round shape, a round active site. The structure is similar like a round structure. So the substrate is having a round structure, can fit into that enzyme, into that enzyme active site. Even the competitive inhibitor is there. See, another chemical is also having a same round structure. So what is the chance of fitting into that active site? The chance is 50%. The substrate, maybe a substrate also can fit into that active site, or the competitive inhibitor can also fit into that active site. That is, the enzyme can accept any chemical which is in that shape, according to, if you assume it as a lock and key model. So that shape, depending on that shape, the chance of the substrate to bind with the enzyme is only 50%. Maybe the substrate can fit into that, or the competitive inhibitor, that means another chemical which is having same structure, same similar structure, which can fit into, in the place of substrate, it can fit into that active site. So what happens if the substrate can fill, it can form the product. But if the competitive inhibitor comes and fit into that active site, so there is no enzymatic action and there are no products formed. So here you can see in the picture, the competitive inhibitor getting into the near the active site and getting fixed to the enzyme. Inhibitor competes with the substrate to bind with the enzyme here. And here, substrate is not able to bind because it is already occupied by the competitive inhibitor. Here, this process is very much useful in the medical field. That is, suppose this substrate which is combining with the enzyme and forming the products. So this should be stopped. That is, some disease is occurring due to this bacterial enzyme should be stopped. Should be stopped means the substrate should be stopped to combine with that enzyme. So the competitive inhibitor should come and fills to the enzyme, and it can stop that formation of products. So here, that is why this is called as the competitive inhibitor. It is because, why it is called as the competitive inhibitor? Because it is very similar to the substrate molecular structure. Due to its close structural similarity with the substrate, the inhibitor competes with the substrate for the substrate binding site of the enzyme. Here, this is it is also reversible. Means here, all the competitive sites are coming, all these competitive molecules are coming, and their chances are 50%. Even the substrate can fill, that is also 50%. So if the competitive inhibitor comes and occupies the active sites of that enzyme, there is only 50% of products formed. Like that, if continuously the competitive inhibitor the concentration is increasing, suppose the chemicals are more number of competitive inhibitors are there, and the substrate molecules are less, then what happens? Ultimately, the products are formed are decreasing. First 50 competitive inhibitors occupied active sites, and another 50 substrate molecules are occupied in the enzyme. How many products will be formed? 50 products only will be formed. But if there is continuously competitive inhibitors are more and substrate molecules are less, then how much what will happen to the products? Continuously it decreases. So at one stage there will be that no product formation will be formed, because all the competitive inhibitors only will occupy the active site. Now why this is useful? Suppose I can give you an example. If you go to a doctor and if you take a medicine, he will prescribe you for a 2 or 3 days, what you will do? You will take the medicine for 1 day. You will feel that it is stopped. That is, you feel that the disease, you feel it is decreased, and you will stop that medicine. That means what happened? The product's formation is decreased. So you feel the disease also is decreasing, but you won't complete the course. What happens? Again, after a few days, again the disease will increasing. That is, means it is reversible. That is why I told this is reversible. Means it, you that course should be completed until no product formation should be formed. That is, more the competitive inhibitors are there, and more the and the product formation will be less, and continuously at one stage the completely the product formation will be stopped. This is what happens. So competitive inhibitors are very much useful in controlling the bacterial pathogens. That is what here. Malonic acid, one example, if you take malonic acid resembles the substrate succinate and inhibits the succinate dehydrogenase. So here malonic acid structure and succinate substrate structure is also same. So what happens, the enzyme doesn't know which is enzyme can fit any can it is having active site, it can fit either the substrate or the competitive inhibitor. So here competitive inhibitor it inhibits the this substrate succinate inhibits the succinate dehydrogenase. That is what the example is given. Malonic acid resembles the substrate succinate and inhibits the succinate dehydrogenase. So here malonic acid is similar in the succinate. So malic acid, if it comes, it will fit into that enzyme, and so the reaction will be stopped. Such competitive inhibitors are often used in the control of bacterial pathogens. So here, so this is I told you an example how the bacteria can be the disease, how the disease can be controlled. This competitive inhibitors are very much useful. Non-competitive inhibitors. The inhibitors having no structural similarity with the substrate and binding to a enzyme of locations other than the active site, so that the globular structure of the enzyme is changed, are called non-competitive enzyme inhibitors. You see in the picture here, one enzyme is there. The blue part is the enzyme, and the yellow one is the substrate. And here inhibitor, here sir, inhibitor is there. Here also inhibitor is there. It is having different structure. It is some rectangular one, but the substrate is round. And what happens? The substrate, when it comes to fit into the active site, here the inhibitor is not. It is having different structure, but it is binding in another site of the enzyme. It is not fitting into the active site of where the substrate is getting fit. It is fitting in the another location of the enzyme. So what happens if another location it is fit? The shape of the active site is getting differ. So here first it is used to be round in shape, and even the substrate is round, the substrate is coming to fit into that active site. But it, at the same time, if inhibitor comes and occupies the some other location of that enzyme, what happens? The change is, there is a change in the active site. So if the change, if there is the change in that active site, the structure of the substrate cannot fit into that change in the active site. So here there is no formation of the product, so because the structure is completely changing. So if you think about the enzyme not the lock and key, other the induced fit hypothesis is there. If you see that hypothesis, the enzyme can fit into the shape of the substrate like that. But here the same, if inhibitor comes and changes the shape, it comes and it changes the if it comes and occupies the another location of the enzyme, the shape is getting differ. So the substrate cannot fit into that shape, because already inhibitors are occupying its locations, and the active site's shape is altering. Here if you see here, what is happening, there is no product formation, because the substrate is not getting bind to the enzyme. How the products will be formed? So there are no products formed in the non-competitive inhibitors. So here this reaction is completely irreversible. That is, if there is no product formation, how it can be reversed? There is no product formation only. But here in, but before competitive inhibitors, there is a product formation is 50%. We saw 50% of the products are formed first. Then later increasing in the competitive inhibitors, the products are continuously decreasing, and at last there will be no product formation. But here in the single step, the non-competitive inhibitors, the products are not formed. So this is irreversible. For example, cyanide binds to cytochrome oxidase, which is an important role in the cellular respiration. You heard that cyanide, if once taken, the respiration stops. That is, this non-competitive acid acts like a non-competitive inhibition, and the respiration will stop, and the person immediately dies. We can see, we know about the cyanide. If it is taken in the seconds, the death will occur. And next, another example is the penicillin is also a non-competitive inhibitor for the enzyme for cell formation in bacteria. So, for bacterial infections, it is occurring, if any bacterial infection occur for the living organism, we will take penicillin, right? This acts as a non-competitive inhibitor. This is about the non-competitive inhibition. Feedback inhibitors. Feedback inhibition is also called allosteric inhibition. Feedback inhibition is a cellular control mechanism in which an enzyme's activity is inhibited by the enzyme's end product. So, if you see in the picture, the enzyme is having an active site, and the sugar, that is the substrate, is getting comes and fitting and binds to the enzyme, and some products are formed, that is the glucose is formed. So here the glucose molecules are more, if you assume the glucose molecules are, the products are formed more, then these glucose molecules, they come and bind to the allosteric sites of the enzyme. If the more number of products are formed, these more product number of products formed, what happens? These can affect the changer, it can stop the further reaction to occur. That means after the product formation, these product can stop the reaction. To stop the reaction also, these products acts as a inhibitor. So here, these products, after glucose molecules, the blue color of products are glucose. These, if they come and comes and fits into the allosteric sites of this enzyme, there is the change in the enzyme. So here it cannot fit, that green substrate cannot fit into the active site of the enzyme. So there is no reaction, and the reaction stops here. So it means the product is acting as the inhibitor. That is what here, this type of reaction is called as the feedback inhibitors stop this type of enzymatic reactions. Feedback inhibition is a cellular control mechanism in which the enzyme's activity is inhibited by the enzyme's end product. For example, glucose converts into glucose 6-phosphate. That means glucose is converting into glucose 6-phosphate, which is nothing but the product. So here one product is formed. This product, this glucose 6-phosphate, can regulate higher or lower the concentration of the enzyme. Suppose the glucose is more. So that means more molecules are formed, glucose, the sugar is increasing. So the body itself has an ability to stop the formation of the glucose. What happens? Again, the products it occupies that enzyme, and it stops the formation of the enzyme substrate complex. So the reaction gets stopped there, and there is no product formation. It is a part of homeostatic control metabolism. That means there will be a balance of the enzymatic reactions. So this feedback inhibitors balance the control of the home. It balances the body temperatures, or the whole maintaining the whole body enzymatic reactions. These feedback inhibitors are also very much important. The next topic is classification and nomenclature of enzymes. Thousands of enzymes have been discovered, isolated, and studied. Nomenclature is the naming. So one method of naming enzymes is adding "-ase to the root word. So enzymes can be named by adding a "-ase to the suffix. Like suppose maltase, sucrase, "-ase is added to the suffix, like it is a suffix added to the word, like malt. Malt is a substrate, and "-ase, if it is added to that, it becomes a maltase. Suppose, and sucrase is an enzyme for sucrose. Sucrose is there, and that is named as a sucrase enzyme. And "-ase, if we add to that word, it becomes sucrase. One method of naming enzymes is adding "-ase to the root word. And also another method is on the base of source. Suppose bromelain, bromelain is its source is pineapple, which belongs to the family Bromelaceae. So, as it belongs to the Bromelaceae family, that enzyme is named as a bromelain. And similarly, papain is an enzyme which is from it is obtained from its source as papaya. Because its source is papaya, the enzyme is named as papain. Another method of naming an enzyme has two words. The first word is the substrate, and the second word represents the type of reaction. Suppose here pyruvate decarboxylase is an enzyme. Pyruvate is the substrate, that is a pyruvic acid is a pyruvate is there, no? That is the substrate. And decarboxylase is in this reaction the carbon is removed. So here this based on that type of reaction it is named as the pyruvate decarboxylase. And now recent method of naming the enzymes is given by the IUB, the International Union of Biochemistry. Here the enzymes are given as numbers and names. So the new method is the giving the enzymes numbers and names. Now we will see that. Most of these enzymes have been classified into different groups based on the types of reactions they catalyze. Enzymes are mainly divided into six classes. That is, enzyme EC is the enzymatic code. This is one group which is named as oxidoreductase. And second one is the transferase. Third is hydrolase. And the fourth one is the lyases. And fifth class is the isomerases. And sixth one is the ligases. Here, each class with 4 to 13 subclasses and designated accordingly by a 4-digit number. Here EC is the enzymatic code or enzyme code. For example, glucose 6-phosphotransferase, that enzyme code will be written as 2.7.1.2. 2 is the, see here the transferase, in that example you see phosphotransferase is there. So it starts with the class, the main class is the transferase. So here that 2 point, then again coming to the subclasses and sub-subclasses are there. The first digit of the code indicates the major class of the enzyme, while the second is the subclass and the third is the sub-subclass respectively. So last digit is the serial number of the enzyme in that particular subclass. So this is how the IUB naming the enzymes. Let us learn all these six main classes. The first main class is the oxidoreductase or the dehydrogenase. Enzymes which catalyze oxidoreduction between two substrates. Suppose here in these reactions, both oxidation reactions and the reduction reactions occur. That is the removal of hydrogen or the addition of oxygen. Like this, both the oxidation reactions and the reduction reactions taking place. So here, for example, one substrate is getting reduced and another substrate is getting oxidized. Before the reaction, if you see, the S is reduced and S dash is oxidized, and it is interchanging. X is now oxidized and S dash is reduced. Suppose in the example, malate plus NAD plus. Here NAD plus, it is having hydrogen here. And in the presence of malate dehydrogenase, what happened? This in the name itself, dehydrogenase, it is removing the hydrogen from the NAD. So here the products formed as oxaloacetate and oxaloacetate plus NADH plus H plus, that is hydrogen is removed from this reaction. So it is named as it can be named as a dehydrogenase, or these reactions are also comes under oxidoreductase reaction, that is oxidoreductase classes. And the next class is the transferases. The second one is the transferases. Enzymes catalyzing a transfer of group, that is other than the hydrogen, between a pair of substrate S and S dash. See in the example, glucose plus ATP in the presence of hexakinase forms glucose 6-phosphate plus ADP. Here phosphate group is there in the adenine triphosphate. Phosphate group is there. This phosphate group is attached to the glucose, forming glucose 6-phosphate. So this what is happening here? The transfer of the group is happening. So thus the name of this enzyme is transferases. Thus this group or this class is called as the transferases. And the hexokinase is one transferase which is making the phosphate group attached to the glucose, forming glucose 6-phosphate. In the next class is the hydrolases. Here, by addition of water, they break a bond. If the water is added, they break the bond of that substrate. Enzymes catalyzing hydrolysis of ester, ether, peptide, glycosidic, and carbon-carbon bonds or carbon halide bonds or phosphor-nitrogen bonds. So here, for example, if you take fructose 1,6-biphosphate plus water, it gives fructose 6-phosphate plus inorganic phosphate. So in the presence of which enzyme? Fructose 1,6-biphosphate. Here what is happening? In the if the water is added, the phosphate is removed from the fructose 1,6-biphosphate, the phosphorus group is removed, that is inorganic phosphate is removed from the fructose 1,6-biphosphate by the addition of water. So this group of enzymes, this comes under the hydrolases classes. And the fourth one is the lyases. Without the addition of water, that means enzymes that catalyze removal of groups from substrates by mechanisms other than the hydrolysis, leaving double bonds. Here water is not added, but there is a break of the bonds by the removal of the groups from that substrate. These enzymes are called as the lyases. Arginosuccinic acid, in the presence of arginosuccinase, arginine and fumaric acid are formed. So here there is a breakage of that chemical, and so this is without the addition of water. So these enzymes are grouped under the lyases class. And the next class is the isomerases. This isomerase includes all the enzymes catalyzing interconversion of optical, geometric or positional isomers. If you say the example here, ribose 5-phosphate, in the presence of ribose 5-phospho isomerase transformed into ribulase 5-phosphate. So here there is almost same structure, or see here, ribose 5-phosphate and the ribulose 5-phosphate, and ribulose 5-phosphate is an isomer of the ribose phosphate. So there is no change, but they are called as the isomers. Then these isomers will be the reversible also in the reactions. The isomers may be the optical or the geometric or the positional isomers. And the sixth class is the ligases. Enzymes catalyzing the linking together of two compounds. Example, enzymes which catalyze joining of carbon oxygen or carbon sulfur or the carbon nitrogen or the phosphate oxygen etc. bonds. Like means they are joining two compounds, linking. So these are called as the ligases. These comes under the ligases class. Example, glutamic acid from plus ammonia plus ATP, in the presence of glutamine synthesized, they combine to form a glutamine and ADP plus inorganic phosphate. So here ligases means the joining or the linking of two compounds. And the last topic is the cofactors. Enzymes are composed of one or several polypeptide chains. We know almost all enzymes are proteins, and they are chemical in nature, and there are some enzymes which are having a non-protein part also. Okay, and this non-protein part is nothing but the cofactor. Cofactors are the non-protein part bound to the enzyme to make the enzyme catalytically active. Here the protein portion of the enzyme is called the apoenzyme. Means here we know enzymes are nothing but the proteins, but here some enzymes are having the non-protein part also called as cofactor, and the protein part is called as the apoenzyme. So if non-protein part or this cofactor is not present in that particular enzyme, then it is not functional. That means cofactor is also necessary for an enzyme to work. That is, both cofactor and apoenzyme should be present in that enzyme, so then only that enzyme can be functional, and then it that is called as the holoenzyme. Cofactor and apoenzyme together called the holoenzyme, and it is a functional enzyme. So here there are three types of cofactors: the prosthetic group, coenzymes, and the metal ions. First one, the prosthetic group. This is the organic cofactor which is tightly bound to the apoenzyme. That means the cofactor which is the non-protein part is very much tightly bound to the protein part. That is, it is not, it cannot be separated. This is called as the prosthetic group. Peroxidase is the enzyme which breaks hydrogen peroxide to water and oxygen. Here, water in the presence of peroxidase forms water and oxygen, H2O and O2. Here, heme is the prosthetic group and it is a part of the active site of the enzyme. And next is the coenzymes. These are the organic compounds which are loosely attached to the apoenzyme. Means this cofactor is very much loosely attached to the apoenzyme, that is a protein part. This non-protein part is loosely attached. In the prosthetic group, we saw the protein part and the non-protein part are tightly attached. But here in coenzymes, the cofactor is loosely attached to the apoenzyme. These coenzymes are derived from the water-soluble vitamins. Example, both NAD and NADP contain the vitamin niacin. And next cofactor is the metal ions, and these are also called as the activators. A number of enzymes require metal ions for their activity. They form coordination bonds with side chains at their active site. For example, zinc is the cofactor for the proteolytic enzyme carboxypeptidase. And catalytic activity is lost when the cofactor is removed. As I said, if the non-protein part of the cofactor is removed, then the enzymatic activity is also stops. So the enzyme activity is also lost. The catalytic activity is lost when the cofactor is removed from the enzyme, which testifies that cofactors plays a crucial role in the catalytic activity of the enzyme. So this states that that cofactor is very much necessary for the activation of an enzyme. That is, a non-protein part is also very much necessary for the activity of the enzyme. So if the non-protein part, that is a cofactor, and the protein part, the apoenzyme, together, if they are present only, then only the enzyme will be functional, which is called as the holoenzyme. And we covered all the topics in the textbook, which is in the chapter enzymes. So this is the conclusion of enzymes chapter. Write down the questions in the very short answers. Questions, so you could write, what is meant by the feedback inhibition? Distinguish between apoenzyme and the cofactor. What are non-competitive enzyme inhibitors? Mention one example. In the short answer questions, write briefly about enzyme inhibitors. And second one is explain different types of cofactors. By this, we have completed the chapter 3 lesson, that is the enzymes. Part 1 also, you have to go through it. And also, this is part 2. And by this, we have completed the chapter enzymes. If you have any doubts also, you can again refer to the video. You can understand. Thank you, students. Thank you for watching.